about the snack game at JSConf for you? It's on point. Thank you, organizers. You're doing a great job. Also, Malta's dance party that's playing in the background. Amazing. Killing it. OK, I want all of you to get pumped right now because the journey we're going to go on is going to blow your minds. We're going to talk about something I've been obsessed with recently, which is sequential art, comics, and SVGs. My name is Zahra, Zjab on the internet. I work at Bustle Digital Group. I'm an engineer. Bustle is a feminist publication for millennial women with an emphasis on inclusivity, positivity, and empowerment. What I love about working in media and publishing is that as an engineer, I get to be a digital storyteller. I get to tell stories that become relevant on an emotional as well as an intellectual level. One of the things that we pride ourselves on at Bustle is breaking out of the standard article format. For example, one of the storytelling formats that we've experimented with is this interactive flowchart. It's a choose-your-own-adventure format that breaks you out of the monotony of just reading an article and forces you to make decisions and think differently than you would otherwise. It tells you a story and walks you through the journey, giving you clues along the way. And I think the best way to convey something is to tell a story, whether that's educating, entertaining, or persuading. And when we think about the web, there are so many different ways where in our daily lives we tell each other stories, whether that's through movies, photographs, or tweets. And what all of these have in common is that they break the story into pieces arranged in a very specific way where you move sequentially through time. One of the best known forms of telling stories in a sequential format that predates the internet and the moving image is, of course, comics. Will Eisner, the master comic, uses the term sequential art when describing comics. And Scott McCloud, who's a brilliant comic book artist, gets in depth about the different forms of sequential art in his book, Understanding Comics. Scott McCloud has a beautiful example of what Will Eisner is talking about when he refers to sequential art. He says, "Where taken individually, the pictures on the left are just pictures. But when they become part of a sequence, even if that sequence is only two, the art of the image is transformed into the art of comics." He goes on further to define what we talk about when we talk about comics. He says, "Juxtapose the pictorial and other images in deliberate sequence, intended to convey information and/or to produce aesthetic response from the viewer." Comics have been around for a very long time. In fact, they predate the internet by centuries. Here's a comic from 32 centuries ago for the tomb of Mena, an ancient Egyptian scribe. And what's interesting about this comic is that the Egyptians read their comics zigzag. And then on the other side of the world, archaeologists have discovered ancient paintings in Mexico created 2,700 years later, organized similarly. Even though this doesn't look like a modern comic, what we're looking at is still a story told in a deliberate chronological order where you start on the bottom left and end on the top right. There are no panel borders like we're used to, but there are still clear divisions of scene. Now, I have no idea when or where the first comic was created in history, but the one invention that is a huge deal in the history of comics and sequential art is the invention of printing. Printing turned the art form that had been a diversion for the rich and the powerful and allowed it to be enjoyed by everyone. So given the long legacy of comics and as an art form, and given that print changed comics, how does the internet then change our relationship to sequential art? And what does it mean for us to go from print comics to post-print comics, as in comics in the digital age? For us at Bustle, one of the first steps we took into post-print comics was an animated Instagram story series called Sunday Comics, which mixed the visuals of comics with sound, motion, and interactivity. We produce these once a week. Sometimes there were a series told over a span of a few weeks, and sometimes there were just one-offs. They were super fun to make and super fun to watch. Which then made us wonder, how can we take this further? How do we push the boundaries of the browser and bring a similar experience to the web without making them difficult to produce? We didn't want to just adopt the shape of the previous technology of print comics that we were already acquainted with. For example, you could just draw a comic, scan it in, into an article and then say that you brought comics to the web. But to me, that's not very interesting. I wanted to take my learnings from the ancient comics, where there's a single unbroken reading line, while taking advantage of all the things that the browser had to offer. So I set out to create stories in the form of sequential art on an infinite canvas along the y-axis. So this is the comic experience we built in its final form. We wanted to recontextualize sequential art in the unique capabilities of the browser while emotionally engaging the audience. For example, notice that there's this interesting parallax effect, where things that are closer scroll more quickly than things that are in the background. Everything is full screen to take advantage of the beautiful retina displays, where you can see all this incredible detail. And when you move the mouse, things move around with you, and you can change your perspective within the frame. It gets the viewer involved, and you have to interact with it to see everything in its full glory. Sometimes you even have to move it around to see the text. If you're on a laptop or your phone, you can go to bustle.com/comics right now and check it out on yourself, or check it out by yourself while I'm going through this. So how did we do this? And of course, the answer is the solution to most things on the web. I'm just kidding. There's zero React involved. It's SVGs. It's not on brand. React is not on brand. OK, so the SVGs are a good tool to have and use, especially for storytelling, because they're resolution independent. So they're sharp on any display, which means you don't have to do any image replacement for different resolutions. And of course, they're easily scalable for responsive designs, so you don't have to produce a bunch of different assets with different screens. And they're super easy to animate, which makes them the most fun. The fact that SVGs allow us to create these incredibly rich narratives is mind-blowing. They're truly one of the coolest things you can play around with as a developer. So how was this built? The first step was to get the parallax working. And if you're thinking to yourself, why parallax? First of all, why not? And second of all, because showing static web content can be boring. Parallax adds depth to the scene and creates a sense of physicality. When appropriate, why not let your visitor interact with your site and explore things on their own initiative? Instead of using static images, you get a 3D presentation controlled by your own scrolling. If given the chance, why not use the opportunity to tell stories in an engaging and interactive way? In practice, instead of calculating the parallax movement in JavaScript, we challenged ourselves to do as much in CSS as possible. Shout out to JSConf EU. To create the parallax effect in pure CSS, we have to move into 3D space by using 3D transforms. To activate 3D space, an element needs to be given the prospective CSS property, which then enables 3D space for its child elements. So you define the height and the prospective style properties of the parent element, and that will lock the perspective to its center, creating a 3D viewport with a fixed origin. The scrolling speed of the parallax elements is achieved by applying the translate Z function to the transform property of the child elements, which places the elements along the Z axis by moving them farther away or closer to the user. After experimentation, we picked a maximum distance to be the background layer. The last layer sits at that distance, and we evenly distribute the remaining layers from background to foreground. And here's what it looks like in Illustrator, where there are 7 layers, and those layers are distributed evenly between the foreground and the background. Because we're using perspective to achieve the parallax movement effect, when we move things farther along the z-axis, they're naturally going to get smaller. But the illustrators have already drawn their comics to scale, which makes this behavior inappropriate. So we need to do some depth correction. We need to apply a scale transform to the element so that it appears to be rendered at its original size. On the left, we have the scale transform applied, versus on the right, there is no scale transform. The good news is as things move farther away, they get smaller at a predictable rate. So we can apply a scale transform to render it at its original size. This way, we get the parallax effect of moving things along the z-axis without the size distortion. The advantage of this is that we just set a few CSS properties, and the browser takes care of everything else. And there's very minimal JavaScript required to set up the comic. So again, this is how the scene will look with and without depth correction. So on the right, we can see what happens when we translate things on the z-axis without applying scale. And on the right is the depth correction with the scale applied. So for example, the farther back in the scene an element is, we're going to apply a larger z translation to it. But it also means that we're going to apply a larger scale factor to compensate. Now, even though this seems like fun and games, and browser support is generally excellent for SVGs, it's a whole other story when you apply CSS transforms to them. This is especially painful when it comes to animations, because scale, position, rotation, and skew are so fundamental. When you apply transforms to an element inside the SVG, there are browser bugs and inconsistencies. This gift is from an excellent article in CSS Tricks, which shows how different the same animation looks on different browsers. IE and Opera don't honor CSS transforms at all on SVG elements. Instead, you must assign the value to the transform attribute. We could use tools like GreenSock Animation Platform to make it work. But then what's the fun in using a third-party library instead of figuring out how to do it on your own? So our solution was to explode the SVG, where each layer in the SVG becomes an SVG element of its own. And this allows us to apply our CSS transform reliably across all browsers. Here's what the SVG looks like in Illustrator, with six layers making up the scene on the right. And then on the left, we have that same SVG with each of those six layers exploded into their own SVG element. And they're all stacked on top of each other to make it look like the original. Another cool thing about these comics is the movement in them. As you move your mouse or your phone, everything moves with you. The closer the layer is to you, the more it moves. And the farther away it is, it moves less and less. Just like in real world, things that are closer to us move faster than the things that are farther away. This is one of the constraints we wanted to add, because we didn't want the designer to think about how to animate each movement and to just have it done for them automatically based on the number of layers they used. What's cool is the effect it gives you a sense of being in the scene. And as an anecdote, the designer started putting things in their illustrations where you have to interact with it to see what's going on in the whole story. So how did we manage to get the page to respond to the mouse and the gyroscope movements? With the help of our good friend from our math days, logarithmic scale, which is a nonlinear scale used when there is a large range of quantities, earthquake strengths, for example, which is not unlike shaking your phone or moving your mouse in the digital world. So here's the code that maps movement on a linear scale, like the mouse moving on a logarithmic scale that we use to actually transform each layer. And then you apply the shift to an event listener based on device orientation or mouse movement. As a visual example of how log scale works, as the mouse moves in the center, the layers move quite a bit. But as you get closer to the edges of the browser, they move less and less, because you don't want things to fly off the screen. Again, just like in an earthquake. What's also cool is that you have to move your mouse around to see what's in the mirror, or what's in the background and behind the window on the left. An important goal of this project was to allow our designers to be productive in the tools they already know. One of the reasons for using SVGs is that our designers already know how to make them in a program they use day in and day out, Adobe Illustrator. One thing we could have done was spend half a year building an online comics editor. But Adobe has already done that for us by creating Illustrator. And our designers already know how to use them. And one of the coolest parts of this for me personally is that even though they have the same tools and constraints, they each have completely different processes for how they design. Allison Gore, for example, storyboards the entire comic. She starts with a loose plan, figures out how the panels are set up and relate to each other, and then moves on to Illustrator and deconstructs the layers to figure out how their interaction works. These are some examples of her work. It's cool to see the behind the scenes. Austin sometimes draws out his main characters on paper and then moves into Illustrator to draw out the whole scene. An interesting thing about Austin's work is he uses a lot of color. And when I asked him about it, he said it's because he's from New Orleans. And when he grew up surrounded by beautiful colors. And since he's moved to New York City, he misses the how colorful things are. And so he tries to remind himself of home in his work. Alyssa draws out her characters and on paper and tries to get them to their simplest form in order to create more iconic moments. She also draws out pieces of the scene on paper and writes herself lots of notes before moving on to drawing out the scene in Illustrator. She draws lamps and reminds herself, this is what the Netflix logo looks like, or this is what my table should look like. Alyssa also believes that it's best to give the audience clues without drawing out every single detail for them and letting them figure things out and put pieces together on their own. She believes minimalism goes a long way when it comes to comics. Dawn draws out some of parts of the story and tries to make sense of the story before doing anything else, and sometimes ends up working with the writer more closely to change the story entirely, based on her first impressions of it not making sense once put into drawing. She tries to figure out the character's emotions on paper rather than the details. She also feels like she's playing God while trying to figure out what to place in the background, or what does the character look like, or what does the room look like, or what color is their hair. Mary figures out the basics of each panel on paper, but one of the interesting things about her process is that she likes to draw out her main character with different emotions and from different viewpoints before she starts laying things out. It's been very rewarding to work on these things because for relatively little engineering work, we can help designers create these experiences that they've never made before and that our viewers have never seen before. I'm personally a huge fan of the theory of meeting your audience, your designers, and your collaborators where they are today. And so the most important lesson I want you to take away from this talk is meet your users where they are. I know we all have instincts to rewrite everything and create all these new tools, but it's really, really important to think about how to leverage existing tools. And SVGs are a perfect example of that. You probably already work with designers. They already know Illustrator. What are some ideas that you have that you, if you were able to get out of SVGs, what would you do? I showed you two examples here with interactive flowcharts and comics. Both of these have super simple rules that the designers can follow. Figure out your layers, export to SVG. Done. It's also important to note that setting constraints is OK. Some of the designers were definitely a little hesitant about not having enough control over the animation, or the depth, or the movement, or wanting to be able to animate certain things differently. But the answer I always gave was the same as I'm sure some of you have given once or twice. PRs are welcome. But all joking aside, I think having constraints and having to work within limits creates more opportunity for creativity and innovation. The way they're using Parallax to enhance the story in these two examples is mind-blowing. And again, it's been super rewarding being a part of it. So the question I have for all of us is, what are other things we can do by exploring and using Illustrator as a development tool almost? Or are there more file formats? Are there other tools people around us already know that we can use the power of JavaScript to parse, analyze, and augment? I don't know. Thank you. Where's Malta's music?